تعالى ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا إنه من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر وأحسن الهدى هدى محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار وما قل وكفى خير مما كثر وألهى وإنما توعدون لآت وما أنتم بمعجزين أما بعد all praise is due to Allah. We praise Him and we seek His aid and forgiveness. And we seek refuge in Allah from the evils of ourselves and bad deeds. Whomsoever Allah guides, no one can mislead. And whomsoever Allah led astray, there is no guidance for him. I bear witness and testify that there is no deity worthy of worship except Allah. And I bear witness that Muhammad is his last messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We who have believed fear Allah as he ought to be feared, and I not accept in the state of Islam. O mankind, be dutiful to your Lord, who created you from a single soul, and created from it its mate, and scattered from both many men and women. And fear Allah, to whom you demand your mutual rights and have a good kinship relations. Indeed, Allah is always watching over you. O you who have believed, fear Allah and speak always the truth. He will fix your deeds and forgive your sins. And whoever obeys Allah and His Messenger will achieve a great success. Indeed, the most truthful book is the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the best guidance is the guidance of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the worst matter is the innovation in the deen. And every innovation in the deen is misguidance. And every misguidance will end in the hellfire. And to proceed, my brothers and sisters in Islam, it is reported in Sahih al-Bukhari and Muslim and narrated by Abu Sa'id al-Khudri radiallahu anhu, that a person before Islam, before Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, committed the worst major sin any man can commit. Committed serious crimes, but he started to feel remorse in his heart. And he wanted to repent. So he asked about somebody to give him a fatwa. People instructed him to seek this fatwa from a worshipper, a person who is always in the house of worship, worshipping Allah a lot, but unfortunately without a knowledge. So some people are like that. They worship without seeking knowledge. They don't study their religion. They live a long life worshiping their Lord, but not upon guidance, not upon the light of knowledge. So this worshiper who was ignorant, when he heard about the serious crimes of this criminal, he closed the door of mercy of Allah in his face. He saw the crime is so big. So he told him, there is no way for you to repent. If you repent, your repentance will not be accepted. And as we all knew, once we close the door of the mercy of Allah in the faces of people, we increase crimes. So this criminal killed the false mufti. The ignorant worshipper got killed because of his wrong fatwa. The criminal who wanted to repent, who was waiting for somebody to show him the light, to show him the mercy of Allah. But unfortunately, he did not find one. And the one who made a false fatwa was the victim of his own fatwa. The criminal told himself, if no repentance, and I am criminal, and no exit out of this, so what is wrong with making more crimes? So once the door of mercy is closed, you increase crimes. Same thing happened with a shaitan. When a shaitan showed arrogance, and he rejected the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and debated his Lord. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cursed him and closed the door of mercy in his face. So he became the devil, the one who whispered to make others commit crimes. And this person, after he committed the crime and killed the worshiper, he still have the feeling inside him. He wanted to repent. He felt the remorse. So he kept asking, maybe he may find another fatwa. So in the second time, he found the right mufti, a knowledgeable worshiper. Not ignorant worshiper, a knowledgeable worshiper. So he told him, I committed this kind of crimes. I did all these major sins. Is there any chance for me to repent? So the knowledgeable person told him, who can stop you from repentance? Who can stop you from repenting to your Lord? The door of repentance is open. You can do so. But listen to this carefully. He gave him an important advice for his repentance to be accepted and for him to be successful in his repentance, to stay firm upon his repentance. He told him, there is an important advice. Listen to it carefully. Leave the city that you are living in. Leave the community that you are associating yourself with and go to another city. He mentioned to him a specific city. He told him, go there because it is a healthy environment. You can live there and you will find people helping you to succeed in your repentance. You will live with better people. Because if you repent in a bad environment, you know what's going to happen to you? People will keep reminding you. They will keep telling you, do you remember? You committed crime. Do you remember? You did this and this and this. Are you acting as a good person? Did you forget who you are? They will keep telling him that. And those who committed the sins with him, the bad company of him, will keep inspiring him to null his covenant to Allah and to join them again in wrongdoing. And because the person is the product of his society, as they say, it takes a village to raise a child, because every element in this village will contribute to the development of this child. So he took the advice seriously and left his city in his way to the other city, implementing the advice of the scholar. But once he came out of his city, the angels of death came to take his soul. He passed away. And as we all knew, the one who will call your soul to get out is the angel of death. We don't know his name. His name is not mentioned in Islam, neither in the Quran nor in the Sunnah. But once the soul is out, this soul will be given to a specific squad, team of angels, working with their leader, the angel of death. So once the soul came out, two groups of angels came to take the soul from the angel of death. Prophet Muhammad said, alayhi salatu wasalam, in hadith reported in Musnad Imam Ahmad, narrated by Al-Bara, فَلَا تَدَعَهَا الْمَلَائِكَةُ فِي يَدِ مَلَكِ الْمَوْتِ طَرْفَتَعِينَ. So once the soul is out by the command of the angel of death, group of angels will take the soul from him. But which group? There are angels that come from paradise to take the soul to the mercy of Allah. They come in very beautiful faces. But if the person was bad, you will find different squad. Group of angels are coming to take the person to be punished. They have scary faces and they are tough. So two groups of angels came, arguing with each other. The first group said, he never did something good. He committed major crimes, serious offenses, and he did not do any good. And the other group said, but he did repent. They kept arguing and debating each other until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent an angel to them to judge between them. This angel said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants you to measure the distance between the city that he left and his death place, and the distance between his death place and the city that he is going to. See if he was closer to the first city that he departed or the second city that he was going to, that was his final destination. So when they measured, they found him closer to his destination. So the angels of mercy took his soul to the mercy of Allah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala send to all of us the angels of mercy to take our souls in the time of our deaths to the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So why I started my khutbah today with this hadith? Because of the importance of the environment and the importance of knowledge. A mufti who gave fatwa based on knowledge helped this person to survive the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the ignorant who is talking about what he doesn't know caused more crimes and more evil on earth. So it is lesson for all of us to learn our deen in details, to know the aqidah of Islam, the sharia of Islam, to read and to study with the teachers and the scholars, and to humble ourselves to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the second lesson is the importance of the environment. For anyone to succeed in his relationship with Allah, you need a healthy environment. And it is very clear that Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam spent the time in the beginning of his life in Medina to create this environment, to make it happen. You heard from me a few weeks ago when I was talking about three events happened in Rabi' al-Awwal. Three events. One of them, the birthday of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The second one is the migration of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the third one is the death of the Prophet alayhi salatu wa sallam.
If you look to the migration and you ask yourself, why the Prophet ﷺ migrated from Mecca to Medina? And why he sent the Muslims twice to Abyssinia? The reason, because he wanted a healthy environment for the believers. In Mecca, the Muslims were living under the leadership of tyrants, abused them, tortured them, turned them against each other. They're trying to do evil things. The Prophet ﷺ was leading a minority in Mecca, and he was not able in Mecca to create this healthy environment. But after the migration of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to Medina, he was able alayhi salatu wa sallam. He was able. And if you look to the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if you read the biography of Prophet Muhammad alayhi salam, you will see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allowed the Prophet alayhi salam to participate in the rebuilding of Al-Kaaba when he was 35 years old, 5 years before his prophecy, alayhi salatu wasalam. We all knew that the Kaaba was built in the time of Adam, alayhi salatu wasalam, built by the angels of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The basis of it, the foundation of it, were placed by the angels of Allah. Adam, alayhi salam, made tawaf around the Kaaba with his kids and worshipped Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala around this Kaaba. But the Kaaba was destroyed in the time of the flood of Nuh alayhi salam, the messenger of Allah. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent the flood destroyed the Kaaba. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded Ibrahim and his son Ismail to rebuild the Kaaba and to make it bigger. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded Ibrahim and Ismail to do that. So they did. And the Kaaba was destroyed in another flood. So Quraysh came together to build the house of worship while they are polytheists. Imagine, idol worshippers, polytheists. They don't believe in the correct creed, but they still knew the sacredness of the house of Allah and the importance of the house of Allah in the Arab Peninsula. So they came together to build the Kaaba. And they made a condition upon themselves not to use any haram money. And Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam participated in this effort. Before his prophecy, he was helping his uncles building the Kaaba. And even when the leaders of Quraysh disagreed with each other, the tribes were in dispute with each other, which tribe should get the honor of returning the black stone. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam to come to judge between them. And his judgment was to put his cloth and to put the black stone in the middle and to bring the sheikh of every qabila, of every tribe, the leader of every tribe, to carry this cloth from aside. So both, all of them carried the black stone, and the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam returned the black stone by his hand to its place. So he is getting the reward of the rebuilding of Al-Kaaba. Since it was rebuilt when he was 35 years old, and it will be like that until the Day of Judgment. Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Allah gave him the reward and gave him the honor. And he was preparing Mecca, because Mecca will become a Muslim city. And this Muslim city must be a healthy environment for the believers. And the most important thing in a healthy environment is the house of worship, the house of Allah. And Prophet Muhammad alayhi salam, during his migration, when he passed by Quba, he built the masjid of Quba to the people of this area. Just when he was passing by them, because he knew the importance of the masjid in a healthy environment. And even when he entered Al-Madinah, when he arrived, and you heard this from me multiple times. The Prophet ﷺ, when the people were inviting him to their houses, he commanded them to stay away from his camel, because the camel is enjoying to stop in the place of the masjid. So after the Prophet ﷺ got to know where the masjid will be built, he waited only 15 days and he started construction. Just 15 days. And the Prophet ﷺ with the Muslims, all of them came together, hand in hand, to build the first masjid in Medina upon the taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the Prophet himself ﷺ used to carry the bricks on his shoulder the way he did, and he was participating in the rebuilding of the Kaaba sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he saw Ammar ibn Yasir and Sumayyah, may Allah be pleased with them, carrying two bricks every time. You see, every companion, even the Prophet, each one of them used to carry brick by brick, one by one, except Ammar. He used to take two by two. Every time he carried two bricks on his shoulder, helping the Muslims to put the walls of the masjid. So the Prophet ﷺ said, "Wayha ibn Sumayyah." He was happy for him ﷺ to see this commitment and this work that he was doing. He wanted more reward. So the Prophet said, "Alayhi salatu wasalam, your final provision in life will be a sip of milk. You will be drinking milk before you die. The first thing will enter your stomach, O Ammar, will be a milk that you will drink." And he said that Allah will reward every companion a reward, and he will double your reward, O Ammar. Then he put his hand on the back of Ammar and said, "Taqtuluka al-fi'atul baghiyah." You will be killed by the hands of the transgressors. And this is what happened to Ammar ibn Yasir, exactly the way the Prophet described. And the Prophet ﷺ loved Ammar and told him that when he saw him committed in the mission of the rebuilding of the building of the Masjid of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Until the masjid was built, they made the pillars from the palm trees, and they made the walls from bricks based on their financial ability. And the Prophet started his mission in Medina from the masjid. The masjid was the most important thing in this healthy environment that we are talking about. And the Muslims will never be able to survive in any city or in any village if they don't start with the masjid and care about the masjid more than their own houses. Because Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam cared about the masjid even before he got to know where he will sleep the first night for him in Medina. And you all knew, or maybe most of you knew, that the houses of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam were built after the masjid, not before. So the Prophet alayhi salam kept sleeping in the houses of the companions as guests until he built the masjid first. Then after he finished the building of the masjid, the companions built houses for Prophet Muhammad alayhi salam around the masjid sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So the house of Allah before his own house sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And it is for all of us to learn that the masjid is the most important mean of success. Very important for our healthy environment, especially in country like this. We need the masjid. Because this masjid, after you finish building it, will build you. This masjid will build iman in your heart. This masjid will teach you how to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala according to the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This masjid will protect you from the major sins. This masjid will help you to develop your kids. Now, our efforts, only in the physical building. We are working to build the masjid. It took too long, but we need to finish it as soon as possible, because we need to have this healthy environment that Prophet Muhammad ﷺ built for his companions in Medina. And he was able after that to make them real brothers, to love one another for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He was able after that to make them a perfect servants of Allah. So they earned this certificate that we all are wishing for. The certificate of radiallahu anhum wa radu an. Allah is pleased with them as they pleased with Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you are pleased with Allah, Allah will be pleased with you. And in order to arrive to this level, you need to start from what Prophet Muhammad started. He started from the masjid. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله العظيم لي ولكم فاستغفروا إنه سميع قريب مجيب.
استغفر الله 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 استغفر الله.
بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله عليه الصلاة والسلام. أما بعد, my brothers and sisters, I was asked to stand up after صلاة الجمعة to encourage all of you to donate money for the completion of our masjid. As you heard from me in the beginning of the month of October, we were raising money to buy the doors, 48 doors, and you promised to pay the price of the doors, and alhamdulillah, the money is collected. And the order is placed, alhamdulillah. And the second step was to buy the drywalls, the sheet rocks. And as you heard from the brothers, every 10 panels, the price of it, to buy it, and to install it, and to paint it, and to make it a wall, the complete expenses is 1,000 for each 10 panels. We need 1,650 panels. And alhamdulillah, until now, we got a good amount, but we did not reach 50% of the price yet. We are very close to 50% of the price. So you need to accept to hear this message every other Friday, because we must finish. This community cannot afford to wait more to pay in the street. We all experienced how Salatul Jum'ah was last Friday. The wind, the rain, coming inside here, and we are praying in the street. We need to finish this. And I want to make it clear to anyone here. From the first day the masjid was burned, a lot of experts told us, if you are looking for three stories masjid, you will never finish less than $5 million. We said, no, it's not going to happen. Inshallah, we will finish less. And they said, if you don't have the money, you're going to wait for 5 years. And we did not believe that. We said, no, we're going to finish less. We're going to finish earlier. But subhanAllah, with the financial ability of our community, we were able to raise an amount of money, about 400, 500 every year, 400,000, 500,000. So we work with the money that we have. And once the weather is very cold, the construction stops. Once the money is finished, the construction stopped year after year. And this is the fifth year, not the sixth year. Because the first year was not a year of construction. It was a year for investigation, why the masjid was burned, for the architect to draw, and for permissions, for construction. The first year is not counted. But the masjid was in progress for 5 years now. We cannot afford to stay more. We need to stand up for the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to put our hands together and put all kind of politics to the side until the house of Allah is finished. Before we die, let's make sure that we can stand in the day of judgment to tell Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, together we built this masjid. No one has the right to say, I built this masjid by myself. Nobody did that. I did not do that. And the president of the masjid didn't do that. The board of the masjid didn't do that. It is the effort of every single person here. Every single one. Not only the one who is making the decisions in the office. You raised money. You paid from your money. From the provision of your kids. You did that, so you are part of this. And you are promised, when you build a house for Allah Azza wa Jal to be worshipped in it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will build a house for you in Jannah. But you need to get it done. You know what happened? Somebody told me, when I saw the building from the street, when the scaffold was removed, I was crying. I was happy. He was happy that the masjid became very beautiful like that. He started to feel it. Imagine when the masjid is completely finished and you are praying inside this masjid with 2,500 people, 3,000, all of them praying Jumu'ah, and you was part of this effort, and you will be reflecting and thinking that because of those reasons, Allah will give you your share of the reward of every single worshipper worshiping Allah inside. And you heard it before from us that the muazzin gets the reward of adhan, and the khatib gets the reward of the khutbah, and the one who is cleaning the masjid will get the reward of cleaning, and the one who is making decisions in the office will get the reward of his decisions if his decisions were made sincerely and correctly. And you will get the reward of all those people. Because it happened because of your donation. It happened because of your support. So you get the reward of all of these people. You will get the reward of the khatib while you are not khatib. You will get the reward of the one who's cleaning the masjid while you didn't do it. You will get the reward of every board member, even if you did not sit in any meetings. You will get the reward. Because all of what happened because of you. Because of your effort. You can walk proudly in the street beside your wife and kids and tell them, I was part of the team who built this place. Every and each one of you. So let's do this. Let's finish it. Let's feel happy about our success and our achievement. We don't want to be burdened with the negative feeling that we have that we didn't finish it. And the only reason we didn't finish is money. Nothing else. In America, everything by money. Money talks. So you need to stand up, put some money, get it done. And we will be able to do it, inshallah. And ask Allah Azza wa Jal, when you donate, to build a house for you in Jannah, you have right to ask for that. Because this is the promise of Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. He promised that. Build a house for Allah, Allah will give you your address in Jannah. Clear statement from the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Go to your grave while the hasanat are following you. Not only preceding you inside your grave, your hasanat will follow you. And your hasanat will be increased while you are sleeping in your grave because it is ongoing charity. And you will see mountains of hasanat in the day of judgment. Not only the hasanat that was written in your lifetime, not the hasanat that was done in this place after your death. Think about it. Think about you when you are resurrected under the shade of your donation. As Prophet Muhammad said, alayhi salam, think of that. Think about passing above as-sirat, above Jahannam. And everybody is walking as fast as he has from hasanat. See how much hasanat you have? And your hasanat will decide your speed. The Prophet said some people will pass the sirat like an eye wink. And some people will pass the sirat like the lightning in the sky. Very quickly. Some people will pass in the speed of the wind. And some people will pass above the sirat as if they are riding horses. And some people will be passing above the sirat as if they are running, and some of them will be struggling. So think of that. Participating in efforts like this will give you a lot of hasanat so that may speed your passing to the Sirat above hellfire. Think of that. And as I repeat, put all negativities to the side until we finish the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You may finish this and die after that. You'll be proud of yourself. So أقول قولي هذا وأسأل الله عز وجل أن يعيننا على شكره وذكره وحسن عبادته. اللهم إنا نسألك رضاك والجنة ونعوذ بك من سخطك والنار. اللهم إنا نسألك أن تطهر قلوبنا وأن تشرح صدورنا وأن تؤلف على الحق قلوبنا. اللهم إنا نسألك بأسمائك الحسنى وصفاتك العلى أن تردنا جميعا إلى دينك مردا جميلا، وأن ترينا الحق حقا وأن ترزقنا اتباعه، وأن ترينا الباطل باطلا وأن ترزقنا اجتنابه. اللهم أصلحنا وأزواجنا وأولادنا واجعلنا صالحين مصلحين. اللهم إنا نسألك أن تهدينا وأن تهدي أزواجنا وأولادنا وأن تجعلنا هداة مهتدين. اللهم إنا نسألك موجبات رحمتك وعزائم مغفرتك والسلامة من كل إثم والغنيمة من كل بر والفوز بالجنة والنجاة من النار يا عزيز يا غفار يا رب العالمين. اللهم من أرادنا والإسلام والمسلمين بخير فوفقه إلى كل خير، ومن أرادنا والإسلام والمسلمين بشر فاجعل كيده في نحره واجعل تدبيره وتدميره واجعل الدائرة عليه يا رب العالمين. اللهم إنا نعوذ بك من شر كل ذي شر أنت آخذ بناصيته. اللهم أعنا على تمام بيتك، اللهم أعنا على بناء مسجدك، اللهم أعنا جميعا على بناء بيتك. اللهم خذ من أموالنا حتى ترضى. اللهم أعنا على ذكرك وشكرك وحسن عبادتك. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون، وسلام على المرسلين، والحمد لله رب العالمين. قوموا إلى صلاتكم يرحمكم الله.